My immense love for this six-season Netflix original series Bojack Horseman has never been communicated on this channel. This is currently being rectified. The show displays the colourful and complex world of celebrity life primarily from the viewpoint of a jaded actor and addict, Bojack Horseman. In order to explore its themes effectively, the show requires layered characters, which it undoubtedly provides. The abrasive, sarcastic, fragile, guilt-ridden, misguided Bojack voiced by Will Arnett from Lego Batman. The eccentric, absent-minded, surprisingly talented and emotional Todd voiced by Aaron Paul from Breaking Bad. The principal, troubled Diane Nguyen voiced by Alison Brie from Community. The hyper-competent, long-suffering Princess Carolyn voiced by Amy Sedaris from Strangers with Candy. And the cheerful, excitable, surprisingly flawed Mr. Peanut Butter voiced by Paul F. Tompkins from Bojack Horseman. Other important roles include Sarah Lynn, voiced by Kristen Chahl, from Gravity Falls, and Herb Kazaz, voiced by Stanley Tucci from films. Every supporting character is shown to be equally three-dimensional, and sympathy is encouraged even in the least conventionally sympathetic figures shown in this world. A world that is exceptionally constructed through use of distinctive, recurring locations, incidental but omnipresent subplots or ideas. Like, there's one example where... Oh my god, Erica! I haven't seen you in ages! Erica! Sorry, I'll be back in a second. Right, as I was saying, there are also examples of geniusly observed anthropomorphic behaviour, societal attitudes, and its addressing and explanation of certain areas of cartoon or general sitcom logic, all while displaying meticulous continuity. The show's consistent and ranged humour is another considerable asset, exploring excellently observed, refreshingly honest social satire, advanced wordplay, absurdism, intellectual pop culture references, and unadulterated dry wit. All of these strengths are elevated by the show's most frequently noted achievement, its genuine emotional involvement. Thanks to sensitive, accurate and understanding representation of mental health issues, offering familiarity and potential solace for any viewers who've suffered seriously with self-confidence, suffocating regret or destructive, uncontrollable impulse, met with occasional believable undercurrents of hope. Features that are made all the more rewarding due to the fact they communicated effectively through a cartoon about a talking horse. The fact that several characters are anthropomorphic animals rather than humans is obviously a choice that was made because... I mean, the obvious reason for this was... I'm not entirely sure on that one. The characters being animals is really, if ever, necessary for the plot. I assume the original rationale was that an image of a cartoon horse would draw more immediate attention than an image of a cartoon person. And of course, Bojack Human is a much less marketable title, as I found out a year before this show was released with my own Netflix series, Bojack Human. So detailed is this show's emotional power that it can be forgotten that Bojack is a horse. Though to be fair, in the many conversations I've had with horses in real life, I've ended up forgetting the same thing. The art style is impressively free, effectively simple, and is subject to sparingly used and extremely pleasing changes whenever a character's mindset is being vividly explored. Bojack Horseman is so gloriously unrestricted, it's given opportunity to subvert typical formula with extremely unique framing devices or locations, given individual and fitting personalities to certain episodes, a trait that is furthered by versatile, passionately performed and crafted music, perfectly encapsulating every necessary mood. Several online reviews have stated that several episodes pass before the show becomes enjoyable, but I don't think this is the case. I think that its nuanced presentation is more apparent after season 1, but even the earliest episodes display clearly dramatic and creative elements. My only complaint is the fleeting moments where the comedy-drama struggle becomes clear. This mainly feels apparent to me in season 5, and usually involves Todd, whose antics can feel misplaced in this show, even if they do provide needed relief. And these turbulent moments are much less frequent than the moments in which the comedy and drama balance is exquisitely graceful, perfected to such a high level that the show becomes even more unique. The later Netflix original series Too Grim Birdie is slightly comparable in terms of art style and certain production team members, but I watched the first episode of that and I found it slightly obnoxious. Does it get better? Does anyone know? Bojack Horseman is highly recommended to anyone open to. An intense but fulfilling emotional challenge, as well as a generally entertaining experience. It's definitely recommended over Took and Bertie. I watched the first episode of that and found it slightly obnoxious. Does it get better? Does anyone know? Bojack Horseman is bravely experimental, while also being completely understandable, amusing, and surprisingly life-affirming. A Netflix original masterpiece if ever there was one. I'm seriously considering making a series of videos in order to analyse specific Bojack Horseman episodes. A general review such as this one arguably disservices a show that so desperately deserves detailed examination. Thanks for watching my video on Bojack Horseman, and if I don't see you on the next one, I will hope it's because you're watching Bojack Horseman. Or failing that, my virtually unknown Netflix series Bojack Human. Or indeed failing that, Tucker and Bertie. I watched the first episode and found it slightly obnoxious. Does it get better? Does anyone know? Back in the 90s, I was in a very famous TV show. Bojack the Horse, Bojack the Horse, don't act like you don't know. And I'm trying to hold on to my past. It's been so long, I don't think I'm gonna last.